house.
Welcome to the Set Me Free Radio Podcast.
Are you ready for this?
Hello and welcome to the Set Me Free Radio Podcast. I'm Stephanie Olson. I'm here with
Cindy Hultine.
And today we are going to talk about the busyness of life, how life gets. You have any experience on?
No, not at all. Especially not this week.
Right. Life getting busy and what is sacrificed in that. Sometimes it's family, sometimes it's God, and how we can put our priorities in order, because the reality is, I think, as busy moms, as busy women, and it applies for men too. I mean, you have to, there are a lot of good things we can be doing
right
in our life, but are they God things? Are they the things that God has authored? Because if he's not authoring it for our life, we're not going to have that grace
right
to accomplish it.
Right.
And so that's been a challenging thing for me.
I think, so. I'm just going to sit here and listen to you because I've got nothing on this one. So teach us all, Stephanie. How do you do it? You're like Wonder Woman around here.
I am not. I see. Okay.
She makes it look good, I guess.
There is a misperception that I am really good at this because I'm not. But I think what, you know, there was a time when I was a young mom and I was wanting to be involved in church, and this was before the ministry began, and you know, I was involved in worship and I was in leadership in the church, and my kids were little and I wanted to do everything. And I don't know about you, but as a stay-at-home mom, and I've been a stay-at-home mom all my life, and you know, working not all my life. That sounds
No, because you were a career woman.
I was. And I was a child and I was a teenager.
You know,
so.
Yeah. Right. You were no better than Jesus in that one. You know, you did come out of the womb.
That's right.
You came as a baby.
I guess I have not been a stay-at-home mom all my life, but ever since I had children,
right,
I have been a stay-at-home mom, or I have worked from home. It's just recently that I've started to, I mean, with the ministry, started going out and speaking, but usually whatever. Anyway, and by just recently, that'd be the last 5 years. So, but anyway, the point is that I wanted to do all of this stuff. And as a stay-at-home mom, I think this perception is we just stay at home.
And you have all of this time on your hands.
Yeah, exactly. All of this time to do, why isn't your house spotless? I don't understand. All you're doing is hanging out with kids all day. I mean, what's that?
Yeah.
But I didn't want to be home all day. I mean, as a stay-at-home mom, I wanted to be out and about. I wanted to take my kids to do things.
Right.
I wanted to, you know, be not home
right
all the time, because that gets a little isolating.
Mundane and boring.
Yeah, exactly.
And isolated.
Yeah, exactly. So I was in all of these activities, and it just started to get remarkably overwhelming as far as getting the house done and the laundry done and then doing the things I wanted to do. But as I have matured in my, not only my life, but in my relationship with the Lord, I think I've matured to the point where I just haven't wanted to grab everything and do everything, but I have wanted to do some things that I really don't believe that the Lord put on my plate.
Mm, okay.
And so it's trying to determine what the Lord would have you do.
Right.
And what
right
you desire
right
to do.
Because there's
sometimes
a lot of great things, and we can get mixed up. Because there's, I mean, think of church alone, how
right
many opportunities there are at church. And church is a great place to serve. But is God really calling you to serve at every one of those places where you're needed or where you want to?
Right. And that's the thing, because where you're needed, you said it. Obviously, in ministry and church, there's a few people doing all of
right
the work. And if you're one of those people willing to step up and do it, you are going to be called upon over and over and over again to do those things.
Right.
So we do have to make some decisions. And the word no, very healthy word.
Right. Yes.
Very healthy word.
Yes.
But you won't be, there will be people that will resent you for saying no to them.
But who are those people? So I have a little example here that I've been kind of, well, I've got a lot of things. I've got a lot of things that I do, and there are some things that need to be gotten rid of, and I'm just not sure what yet. But there is an activity, that I, participate in, or it's with children, and it's a good cause. I really like it. Great group of people, but it takes up, an evening a week.
Mm-hmm.
And, I really had to pray about it because prior to this year, me taking on this role this year, my husband and I used to spend that time going out and spending that time together.
Right.
So this year I've taken on this role that sucks up that time with me and my husband. And my husband and I have noticed, it's like, we aren't getting as much quality time together.
Yeah.
So this volunteer opportunity that I'm taking advantage of, and it's a really great thing, but it's taking away
right.
time with my husband, precious
right.
time with my husband that we truly need in order to connect and have a good marriage. And you've got to focus on, in my opinion, you have to have a good marriage. You've got to focus on your marriage.
Yep.
That's God
that
and
is
your
second,
marriage.
Right. Second to God. Exactly.
So,
no, I agree. And I think that I found that there was a time when the Lord just kind of stripped everything from me. And I think he does that sometimes. He just takes it all away. And when he did that, not only was I able to truly press in to the Lord, which if you don't have that, none of this is gonna...
Right.
I mean, that has to be first.
Right.
And our resting in him, or seeking him, sitting at his feet, that has to be top priority. But then when we do that, it is so much more clear, I think, what he would have us do in our day. Because the Bible says God will direct the steps of the godly.
Mm-hmm.
And so he will take care of those things for us if we just really listen to him and we really press into him. But there was a time when he took everything away from me. And I mean, it was even in the ministry. I mean, you remember this time he started to whittle away all of my activities, but then the ministry, he just kind of almost shut it down. He took away, we had speaking engagements booked, we had events booked, and one by one they were canceled.
It was like a forced quiet time.
It was a forced quiet time. Lord, why?
Out right now.
Yeah, exactly. And it was a painful time, really, because we were questioning what we're doing and are we not supposed to be doing this? But what we found in that, and it was like months. I mean, it wasn't a short period of time.
Yeah, it was a while.
But what he was calling us to do was just really seek him and really press into him and put him above everything. But when we did that, not only did our priorities line up in ministry, and we learned it was this, he brought us to the scripture in Genesis, I think 22, the one with Abraham and Isaac.
Uh-huh, uh-huh, uh-huh.
And what he really showed us was that Abraham was willing, yep, Genesis 22, Abraham was willing to give him even everything he loved, which was Isaac. And the bottom line was, are we willing, or do we want the blessing that he's given us, or do we want the blessor? And
right.
we came to that point where, you know what, it doesn't matter what you're giving us. It doesn't matter what we have, what we don't have. We want you. And that's where he brought us. But I think in that, everything else kind of fell into place too. Our relationships, our family, I mean, everything
right.
really started
right.
to become priority for the entire leadership team. Because
that's true.
That's true. Yeah.
That is true. Everything did.
Yeah.
Everything kind of got reorganized and fit so much better
yeah.
too. It was so much more clear.
Right. So the bottom line is we have to start with our relationship with the Lord. You know, I think about young moms particularly because it's so challenging to be a young mom.
Yeah. I mean, we say, okay, start like with your relationship with the Lord, and you have this baby waking up at 2, 4, and 6.
Yeah. Well, exactly. And I think what that is you have to, you know, women are great multitaskers. We have this great ability to do more than one thing at a time. And think about more than one thing at a time. But that can be a blessing and a curse all at the same time. But when I was nursing my babies, I used it to my advantage because I would get up, I would sit down in the rocking chair, I would turn on praise music, and I would pray over my family, over the, you know, and I think God uses those precious moments and our quiet time with Him. This is the mistake I made for so long. I was very legalistic about my quiet time and what that had to look like.
Right.
And our quiet time changes with every season of our life.
Right, right.
And it should change daily, actually.
And so we can have God be our number one priority.
Right.
And love Him with all of our heart. And maybe at this season in your life, the only thing you can do is pray while you're nursing the baby
or taking the kids. Meditate on scripture at that time.
Yeah, or maybe you have, I used to have little index cards with scriptures all over the house. So when I was, you know, passing by and in the kitchen, I would have a scripture. So that was all I got. My child, I mean, having kids kind of turned my life upside down. I was in for a rude awakening. I had no idea. I was one of those people that thought, oh, I'm going to be a stay-at-home mom. I'm going to have all the time.
Right. What am I going to do all day?
Was I wrong?
Yeah.
I had no idea.
No. It is definitely a challenge. And I think that's what we have to learn in our times with the Lord is that you have to adjust with your lifestyle. He still needs to be first.
Right.
He still needs to be first, but it looks different every day. I will never forget my mom. My mom has always been this amazing prayer warrior, and she's always seemed to have this incredible, incredible devotional life. And I would, when I was young, you know, always she was there reading her Bible. I mean, she just modeled this amazing example. And I will never forget, I had little babies and I was in tears one day and I called her and I said, Mom, how did you do it? How did you spend time with the Lord? How did you read the Bible and pray for an hour and do all this? And she said, I didn't. And it shocked me. And it was such a burden that hers looked different too. She's now that she's, you know, empty nest, obviously she can spend more time with the Lord.
Right. But so what I would think that would be such a relief. Was it a relief to you?
Burden lifted.
Comparing my life with two little kids to my mom's life.
Right.
I mean, it's just different.
It is. Yeah.
And even two people, I think of you and I, we are so different.
Yes.
And multitasking and thinking about, you know, multi-focusing. I am not the best at focusing on two different things at one time. I'm either focusing on this over here, or I'm giving it my all, or I'm focusing, you know, I can only do one thing really well. I can't do a bunch of things well. I can do them, but they're not going to be done very well.
Right.
I see you and I think you can do, I see you doing a bunch of things really well. I'm like, wow, how does she do that? But you know, it's okay. God made me the way He made me and God made Stephanie the way He made Stephanie and it's okay.
You know, I actually recently heard something in a sermon or read something. I can't remember what, but he talked about that very thing that everybody is different and that we need to focus on what God would call us to do based on the gifts He's given us, based on how He has given us
our own strengths,
God-given
strengths. We need to do well with the God-given strengths that we have, not that I can't try and be like you. I would fail miserably. And if you were to try and be like me, you'd be in the fetal position in the corner.
Exactly. But that's okay. Well, and you know, it's funny because my mom is a lot more like you. I am like the only type A personality outside of my husband, but in this ministry, God has placed me with all of these type Z people.
Yeah, I don't know what we're called, but we are not type A.
Not
Stephanie type
A. It is incredible. So he is obviously teaching me something in this, but my mom will say, you know, you just have to slow down. You've got this on your plate, this. And for me, it doesn't feel busy. Like, it's like, no, I'm
I'm fine.
Yeah. But for her, it would be, yeah, psychosis.
I would be in panic mode.
Right.
Oh my gosh.
So for whatever that's worth, we're all so different. And so what is busy to one is not necessarily busy to another.
Right.
And so you have to.
And I think the most important thing we need to remember too is to not compare ourselves. I think that's one of the worst. I bet it's Satan. I think that's one of the greatest ways Satan uses ourselves against each other. I don't know how you want to say that, but is by us comparing ourselves to each other.
I agree. And it's you look at. I mean, even though the women in the Bible, we talked about women in the Bible last podcast, and the women in the Bible who have made this huge impact in life, mm-hmm. which is what he's calling us to do, to make a huge impact right. in the kingdom. They were all so different.
Right.
They did things differently.
Right.
They were different personalities. And that's the beauty of the body of Christ. None of us are the same.
Right.
And even in our own families, my kids, oh my goodness, so different personalities.
Right.
But God uses those different personalities and different giftings to really draw people to his kingdom. So
right.
I think it's really important. But I think it's so critical to put God first, your family second. I mean, I think even with work and we get so we're in America, we are just so caught up in this nonstop rat race and the busyness of life. And it's just, it's kind of sad because we see some of the problems with kids today. Some of the, I have said this many times, I go into schools and it's incredible how many kids do not have good relationships with their parents because their parents don't have time for them.
Right.
And so we have got to put God first, but we've got to put our families second.
Right.
And husband, kids.
Husband, kids.
Yeah. It's so important. So important.
Healthy way. Right.
Yeah, exactly. Now, so one of the things, though, that I was thinking about is what we do with our time when we have time. You know, when we're at home and we are spending time alone or, you know, in this stage in my life, I've got kids in school all day long and I do most of my work from home or I'm going into schools or speaking engagements or whatever. But when I'm home and I'm doing, what am I spending my time with? What am I filling my mind with? Because I think that's important. Am I watching TV from the time that, you know, all day long? Am I, you know, what are you filling your mind with? Well, and not that it's, I mean, it, obviously it's okay to watch TV and it's okay to, you know, just relax, read a book or whatever.
Yeah.
You need those times.
I really do.
You need those times. But I think we have this tendency in our culture, in our society, to turn the TV on from the minute we're home to the time we go to bed. And I mean, I used to do that. I used to have the TV on all of the time.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And we fill our minds with this, you know,
whatever is on
crap,
there,
basically. Yeah. And what I, when I started to eliminate TV from my life, I mean, not that I do watch TV.
It's completely gone.
No.
They don't even have TVs in their house.
Okay. Not
kidding,
true.
Just kidding.
But what, I mean, I watch TV, but it's not a lot. I don't watch a lot of TV anymore. I watch some, you know, mindless shows that Cindy makes fun of me for, but whatever. But that's, you know, a couple of hours, maybe, I don't know, an hour, I don't know, not much, a day possibly. But the rest of the time I'm trying to fill my mind with, you know, worship and it's made such a difference in just the way I think.
Yeah, I can imagine.
Yeah. That's a lot better.
No, I don't, excuse me. I don't watch a ton of TV either, but I do have programs or I'll get I get a little obsessive about things every once in a while. Yeah, so I'll find a show on Netflix, like a series or something, and I'll watch it every once, but as I start getting into it, I kind of watch more and more. But I have chosen to make sure that we have better programming in the house. I went and got, am I allowed to say, like Little House on the Prairie or types of things like that. Yep. Just to expose.
All the old classics.
Yeah, to expose my kids to the other types of programming, because there are certain things that are not allowed in our house anymore.
Yeah.
I know.
It's getting
I know.
Bad.
And it is such a shame what they put on TV these days. And even with, you've got to be careful, because even with a really sweet child program on regular TV, their commercials just don't, they're not really geared towards the audience that the program was for. So
I know.
It's like all of a sudden I find myself, go cover my kids' eyes.
Seriously.
Because this is completely inappropriate.
Right. Well, and I, even some of the kids programming, we don't let our kids watch some of that.
Right.
Like a lot of the kids sitcoms.
Yeah.
Because we
my
have found,
nicks
oh
those.
My gosh, we have found them being more disrespectful, them talking back.
You've got the underage dating they're promoting, which we're not.
Right,
no,
right.
We're not going there.
Right. I mean, it's just crazy, crazy stuff. But so, yeah, I think we just have to be careful what we're doing with our time.
Forgot what we were talking about.
I know.
I could go on for days. We could start just talking TV.
No, I think we have to be, we get busy because we put things in our life that aren't something that God has called us to put into our life. And it's not a bad thing to do those things occasionally, obviously. You don't want to get crazy about it.
Don't get legalistic.
Yeah, but what are you spending your time on? And I've heard people say you can tell somebody's walk with Christ by looking at their calendar and by looking at their checkbook. Where are they putting their time and their money?
Let's see, my calendar. Okay, my checkbook. school stuff.
Probably okay. I don't know.
A few goals.
Yeah, cool. But we digress. But yeah, I think we have to be careful that life doesn't get too busy. So I just want to go to the scripture that we're all super familiar with and that I love.
The two women
that everyone talks about, Mary and Martha in Luke 10. And I love it because everyone's like, oh, I'm such a Martha. No one ever, are you a Mary?
It depends on how you define Mary. Well, I mean, Mary, like, oh, so devoted. I'm probably the Mary in Martha's eyes. Get up and do something. No, I'd rather sit here and just hang out.
So what you're
there
saying,
are things to
you're
be
not devoted,
done.
You're just lazy. Is that what you're saying?
I have a lazy streak. I do. I've had to work really hard at getting off my rear end and getting that fire under my...
All right.
You know, to get things done.
So you're like a pseudo Mary.
Yeah.
Okay.
There you go.
All right.
There you go.
Okay.
Yes. I have to strive in order to be a Martha to actually get the stuff done that I need to get done.
All right. So Luke 10:38. Now it happened as they went. Okay, I've got to be able to move my Bible so I can read it. Now it happened as they went that he entered a certain village, Jesus, and a certain woman named Martha welcomed him into her house. And she had a sister called Mary who also sat at Jesus' feet and heard his word. But Martha was distracted with much serving, and she approached him and said, Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me to serve alone? Therefore, tell her to help me out. And Jesus answered and said to her, Martha, Martha, you are worried and troubled about many things, but one thing is needed, and Mary has chosen that good part, which will not be taken from her. And I think that's such an interesting scripture, because a couple of verses that just really stuck out at me, and God brought us also to this scripture when we were going through that time of stripping everything. And verse 40, but Martha was distracted with much serving. That really kind of blew my mind, because we serve in so many ways. We serve our families, we serve at work, we serve in the church, we serve in our ministry, and that all seems very good, but Martha was distracted with much serving.
Right.
So we can actually be doing things that we think they're great, but we're distracted. Satan uses those things to distract us from the one thing that is needed, and that is seeking the Lord and sitting at his feet.
Right.
And that I found so, I don't know, I find that so one thing is needed. And so there are times I will be sitting at my, because I tend to do a lot of worship just at my keyboard and singing, and I could spend hours just worshiping the Lord during a day. And there are times when I think, I am doing nothing. You know, I'm not doing laundry. I'm not cleaning my house. I should be working on ministry stuff. I should be doing something, grocery shopping.
Doing something.
Right, exactly.
But you are. You are exactly where God wants you. Depending on how many hours you actually do spend at the keyboard, I don't know.
Well, and it goes back and forth, Bible. But, you know, I think that it's sometimes he just reminds me, no, you are doing the one thing.
Right. And he'll take, you know what, and when we do that, he will take care of everything else.
Yeah.
Somehow the stuff gets done.
It does,
I have noticed that. I don't know how that, but he gives you the extra energy or
the grace.
Maybe one of the kids will come in and actually fold some laundry. In my case, that is. They do. Oh, I'm
really?
Sorry. Yeah. Oh, gosh. Are you kidding? I have so much. I hate laundry.
And your kids fold it?
They have to. I tell them. Well, yeah. I mean, I tell them they have to because I tell them to. No. It's part of their job, and then on a good day, they'll actually fold it and put it away or fold it. Yeah, Maddie's pretty good.
That's impressive because her kids are young.
They're 6 and 9. They're old enough to fold their own laundry.
Oh, that's impressive.
But that's how much I hate laundry. I mean, I really don't like doing it, and I'm really not good at it.
That's funny.
Either it's going to sit in the basket or you're going to fold it. No, it's sitting right here. Fold it. Put it away. I've got other stuff
to do. Okay, so God is using your children.
Yes.
Because I was more time.
Because I was very busy that day going out and serving. I didn't have time to fold all your laundry today, so you better do it yourself.
Get her done. Yeah, that's...
Oh, yeah, and I also just got done picking up all your toys over here, so...
Oh.
Sorry.
And that's...
We need to... But for me and my family right now, we really need to work as a team because I've had to... I don't want to be a slave to my house. I don't want to sit at home and just clean. That is mindless. It's just, no, I don't think that's where God necessarily wants me to spend all of my time.
I agree, but I will say that because I think we get this mindset that unless we're doing something super spiritual or something that looks, you know, oh my goodness, I've got to be, you know, doing something super spiritual, whether it's reading the Bible, worshiping, going out and serving, whatever it is, feeding the hungry, exactly.
Right.
But we can be in that same place doing the mundane things in life.
And I think that's where, yes. And I don't mean that I don't do things at home because I actually do enjoy cleaning. I don't like picking up after people.
Right.
I think that's where I start having a hard time. So it's like, but I'm so busy picking up after other people.
Right.
I have a chance to mop the floors. I don't have a chance to do all, you know, clean while the bathroom's clean, but all these other things. It's like we need to work as a team so that I can do my job. You need to do your part. I can do my part. And we'll have a happy family.
Right. And then we don't have that busyness overtaking us all. I think that's a good point. I knew, there was one mom who said that when she makes her kids' bed, you know, when they were little, she would pray as she was making that bed, she would pray over that child. And I thought, oh, that is a really neat thing to do. So, every time you're picking up one of your kids' toys, pray over that child.
So instead of grumbling,
I don't know.
Oh my gosh, why didn't they pick this up?
Or have them pick it up. I don't know. Just saying.
And then you can pray for them as they're picking them up.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But I think, so there's a couple scriptures that I just want to share because I think when we're talking about the busyness in life and what we have going on, that God wants us to rest in him. He wants to give some respite to the weary, to the burdens in our life. So I love these scriptures. Jeremiah 31:25 says, I will refresh the weary and satisfy the faint. I just think that's amazing. I love that. And Matthew 11:28 says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden and overburdened, and I will cause you to rest. I will ease and relieve and refresh your souls." And Psalm 21:2 says, "May the Lord answer you in the day of trouble. May the name of the God of Jacob set you up on high and defend you, send you help from the sanctuary and support, refresh, and strengthen you from Zion." I just love that because God wants us to be refreshed.
I love that. And I do pray that a lot, that Matthew.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness. Tell us what, you know, you pray a certain something in the morning. You pray a lot in the morning. But one of the things is you ask the Lord to order your steps for the day or something. Talk to us about that because I've been doing that lately and I think it's good for people to know.
Yeah, I do because I really want my day. I hate, as a type A person, I really hate to be doing things that are not furthering my day or not, spinning my wheels.
Being productive.
Right,
yes.
Exactly. I cannot stand that, spinning my wheels. Mm-hmm. And so one of the things that I pray is that God would every morning that he says he directs the steps of the godly and that he would direct my steps that day, that he would order my every move during the day to ultimately glorify him. That's what I want to do. So whether I'm grocery shopping or whether I'm speaking in front of a group of women, I want to glorify him. And so I want my day to be as productive as possible. Now, God called me a year ago or so to take one full day and spend it with him. And at first I thought, what? Are you kidding?
Okay. And let me just interject here. Okay. So before, and I didn't know you as well, when you first started doing this.
Yeah. Maybe it was a few years ago.
It was a couple years ago. I was thinking, oh, wow. I was kind of like jealous. Like, oh, I wish I could do that.
Mm-hmm.
Knowing you now the way I know you, oh my gosh.
Yeah.
Okay, so keep going.
Yeah, it was the scariest thing I have ever, and I will never forget it because I remember God saying in my spirit, you know, I want you to take an entire day and spend it with me. And I thought, I don't understand what you're saying because that's a long time. And so the first day that I spent with him, I had my Bible. I got the kids off to school, had my Bible in front of me, had my coffee in front of me and had all my, like my journal. And I think I read the Bible and I prayed and I looked at the clock and it was like a half an hour later. I'm like, okay, what in the world? So I was praying some more and I really felt the Lord was saying, I want to take a walk with you. And I kid you not, I said, Lord, I cannot take a walk with you right now. I'm spending some time with you. I was very legalistic about how we go about our devotion time. And so he asked again. And so I did. I went and took a walk with him and it was the most amazing walk of my entire life and walked for about 2 hours just praying and praising. And it was just beautiful. And it changed my thinking about my time with the Lord. And what I found was that every week, my time with the Lord, and I still spent daily time with the Lord. I got up early and spent, you know, a couple of hours with him in the morning. And because that's just my time. I'm not trying to sound.
I know. And then would you please give us an example of what that looks like? What a typical time with the Lord, 2 hours? Oh my gosh.
Well, it looks a little different now because I have a puppy.
Okay.
And she tries to eat my Bible and stuff. And
that would be perfect for all those moms with the babies out
right,
there.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Okay. It's changed a little bit. But I get up really early before my family does because that is my only time. If I don't spend my time with the Lord early, I won't spend, you know,
And just so you know, Stephanie's able to go to bed at 9:00.
Right. I'm an early.
Okay. So she goes to bed early.
I go to bed
early,
super
early. She gets
early.
Up early. So she's not, going to bed at midnight, getting up at 5.
No. Okay. I am definitely a lightweight when it comes to that. But so I get up early And I, you know, one of the things that I've recently done that has been so incredible, I took the Lord's Prayer and I kind of dissected it and I started to pray the Lord's Prayer the way that it was designed to be prayed. So I would start with praise and then I would start asking God to do His will. And so I would do your will in my family, and I would pray for my family. Do your will in my ministry, so I would pray for the ministry. Do your will, and just go through in the nation and pray, you know, over the nation and the schools and whatever. Just pray over whatever the Lord drops in my heart and His will. And I would just go through the Lord's Prayer like that. You know, any temptations, keep me from those, any forgiveness that I need to do, you know, and confess what I need to confess to the Lord. And I'll tell you, when you pray like that, you find that you're kind of lost in prayer. Now, I would like to say, I think this is really important to say, because I feel like I don't like sounding like, oh, I'm so spiritual, because there was a time when opening the Bible and reading it was torture for me. I couldn't stand it. I couldn't stand to pray. My mom can pray for hours, and I thought, there is no way I can pray for as long as she does. And I hated reading the Bible because I didn't understand it, and I didn't love His word, and I don't even know if I really loved Him, you know, in the way that we're called to. And so I was jealous of those people who had that relationship, so I started praying for it. I started saying, God, give me a love for your word. Give me a desire for your word. Give me a desire for you. I want to love you more. And He honors that. And when you ask Him for that, because that's not natural, that does not come naturally to us. Seeking the Lord is not a natural thing. We have to be drawn to Him, and it has to be the Holy Spirit. And so when I started to pray for that, He really honored that and drew me to Him in such a mighty way. And now I truly would rather spend time with the Lord than just about anything else that I do in a day. But it has nothing to do with me. It's all about Him. I mean, it's all Him doing that through me. Right, I don't do it.
Right.
Because that was not a natural thing. And so, there are times I still don't understand the Bible, obviously. And then pray for Holy Spirit understanding. And there are times when I get bored praying and, you know, you just keep going. You do the things that you don't want to do. You know, it's kind of like working out. There are times when I don't want to get up early and I want to sleep in, and you do what you know you need to do. And I don't want to sound like, oh, every day is just heaven in my home, because it's not. It is an intentional thing that we do. And as we do it more, okay, so I heard somebody say once that scripture and desiring, being hungry for the Lord is like hunger for food. But somebody said it really isn't. It's kind of different, because when you're hungry for food, you eat and you're satisfied. And then you're not hungry for a while, and then you eat and you're satisfied. But when you hunger for the Lord, you feed on the word, you feed on Him, but you get hungrier every time.
Like an addiction.
It is like a good positive addiction. Exactly. If you want to do some addiction switching, this is the addiction switching you should do, because you do, the hungrier you get, or the more you feed on God, the hungrier you get for Him. And it's just kind of a cyclical thing. The hungrier you get, the more you want Him. The more you want Him, the more the hungry, you know, and it just keeps going and going and going. But that's all Him. So yeah, it's got to be this intentional thing, but it cannot be legalistic. It can't be a checklist. There are days when I read maybe one scripture and meditate on that, and that's what I'm going to do, and I pray and whatever. But there are days when I spend, you know, a long time in the Word, just looking, you know, reading scripture passages, and, you know, I don't know. So it just looks different all the time. But the other thing I do is I pray all day long.
Yes. Okay.
And I think that's important.
Yeah.
God is not, He's not put in a chunk of my day. Mm-hmm. He really is my everything. And so everything I do is about him, and everything I do, not like I go into my closet and ask him what I should wear today, but you know, sometimes you need to, cause you really don't know. Sometimes it's torture. No, I'm just kidding. But you know, you do want him to be a part of your every moment,
right,
and
right, right.
And just being
right.
Constantly present.
Right.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
You know, one of the things that you can do, and I think this is really important to recognize, is sometimes when we're talking about that 2 hours with the Lord, some of that 2 hours is spent exercising. You know, I'll tell you what, some of my best moments with the Lord have been on runs. And because I put in worship music, or I will listen to a sermon, or I would just pray. And he has spoken to me more through my time running with him than, you know, a lot of just, it can be such a beautiful time. Mm-hmm. And I think that's okay to do. It's okay
right.
to combine those things.
Right. So it's like in our busy lives, we don't have to separate. Okay, I'm going to go work out for an hour.
Yes.
Oh, I have to spend an hour with the Lord.
Right.
Oh, I have to do this, that,
right.
this thing. You know, maybe even worship while you're doing laundry.
Yeah,
absolutely. You know, yeah, worship and pray while you're exercising. You can worship and pray, like we said, all day long. Anytime. That can be your...
Well, and in fact, one of the things I do, and this is, I mean, I'm sure people think I'm weird for doing this, but again, it's about what you put in your mind.
Mm-hmm.
I really do believe that it's important what you put in your mind.
Yes.
And the Bible says, you know, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever. And I think that listening to worship music, even blasting that, I mean, not blasting, but putting it in your home, there are times when I turn on worship music in my home and I leave because that the Holy Spirit is just moving in that.
Right.
I mean, there's, you know, but I think what you put in your mind is so important. And so I listen to sermons a lot, you know, mm-hmm. find really solid biblical teachers.
Right.
And instead of watching TV, I, you know, pop a sermon on my iPad and walk around the house, and you can clean and you can do laundry, but you're constantly filling your mind with the Word
right.
of God.
Right.
I mean, that's what it's all about, I think.
Right. And you know, even they've got the Bible apps out there, you can hear the Bible. They've got
right.
the Bible on audio.
Exactly.
Turn that on. There's nothing wrong with listening to the Gospels while you're any type of Bible story while you're cleaning or just hanging out. Can I make a point that if you do go out and find sermons, do make sure that they are solid biblical teachers.
Yeah, because there's a lot of, you know, I think about Christian TV. There's a lot of bad stuff out there.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of false doctrine. Mm-hmm. There's, you know, the prosperity movement, the word of faith movement.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of scary stuff out there. So you do want solid biblical teaching.
Right, right. And and never, you know, just because they're on TV or just because, just like us, I mean, if you're hearing something, check
it out.
Check your facts.
Biblically.
Yep. There's nothing wrong with that. And actually, the Word of God says that we need to test that.
Test the spirits.
So test the spirits and make sure that these people, just because it's coming out of someone else's mouth doesn't make it right.
Exactly. Yep. Just because they have a TV show or a radio show or a podcast. Yeah. So I think that's good stuff, because I think it's about making sure. I recently had a thing that I love to do, and I still do love to be a part of it, but it was something where they wanted me to take on a more of a leadership role,
right.
and I really wanted to do it, and I prayed about it, and God, I, you know, really felt God was saying no, and then I ignored him and continued to pray about it. Like, oh, that's not God. Continued to pray about it. I had somebody else tell me, you know, is there something you're walking into that you shouldn't? And I'm like, no. And then I continued to pray about it. And finally, God was saying, you are not to take this on. And I think, okay, even though I want to, if I would have taken it on, what could have happened, you know, obviously, you know, there are certain things that could just get obnoxious or can increase the busyness or just would stress you out or whatever, because God is typically not going to bless and give you the grace. Let me say that.
Right.
God is not going to give you the grace to do it if he is not behind it.
Right.
And doing things, I don't know if you've ever done something without the grace of God. It's painful. It's painful.
No, of course not. I also want to point out that if you are wondering, you know, let's see, we've got Proverbs. Let me just, okay. Proverbs 3:5-6, trust in the Lord mm-hmm. with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him and he shall direct your paths. So if you are struggling on, you know, do I get rid of something? Do I add something to my plate? Do I do this? Do I do that? Can we just say, just like Stephanie, she didn't take on that extra role, though. She kept praying about it. She kept praying about it and kept praying about it.
And tried to ignore the Lord.
But never took it on. So when you're not sure of what to do, of what the Lord is calling you to do, just keep doing the last thing that he told you to do, or just sit and keep seeking him and wait. Don't take anything else on until
right.
you absolutely know for sure that he's telling you to take it on or to drop it or whatever. It's
right.
okay to just sit and seek him and pray and not take action on whatever it is that you're unsure about.
Exactly. And I want to point out that scripture you just read when it says, trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. Lean means to support yourself. And so he's saying, don't support yourself. Don't on your own understanding. Lean on him. Let him support you. And I think that is huge. But you have to be ready for backlash sometimes because people don't like to hear no. And I had, I was called to step. There's been a couple of things that I've been called to step away from. And they were godly things, but they weren't God for me things,
right.
things that God put in, and God wanted me to step away. Well, one person at one time told me I wasn't hearing the Lord. Yeah. And then another person rebuked me for stepping away from it because shame on me for leaving these people who had supported me for so long. So there could be some backlash for doing the things, you know, saying no to people because people, frankly, don't like to hear no. But the people who truly recognize and respect that, you know, if you say, you know, God is not calling me to do this, the people who truly want you to be seeking God
right.
will say, okay, you know what?
I
appreciate you seeking the Lord
yes.
on that or whatever.
Yes. And, you know, we might think, oh, but we're the only ones that can do that
right.
job. Well, you know what? If the Lord's saying, either don't take it or step away from it. And as long as you're not leaving people hanging. Now, let's make sure, you know.
Right.
If you're leaving people in a bind.
You cannot walk away from a commitment.
Yeah, that's a commitment.
That's your word. Yep.
Okay, so you let that commitment end. Let it come to its end date.
Right.
Or, you know, maybe there's a replacement.
We
might think we're the only ones that can do that. That's
yeah.
not necessarily true. If we step away or say no, that's
opens never
up
true. And,
that's opens up that
right.
opportunity for someone else to fill it.
Right.
The person that God wants there.
And sometimes it takes us to step away to have them be
exactly.
raised up into a position.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, we need to kind of get off our high horse
yeah,
on those kind of things.
I'm the only one.
Exactly. Yeah. And allow God to take over. But yeah, I think that's what it's all about. And I'm good with that. I want to be less busy with the things that God doesn't want me involved in and then be more busy in the things that he does because
yeah.
then it's not a burden. I mean, it's not like stressful. It's not that there's not
right.
some stress. Obviously there can be, but you're not feeling that lack of peace that, oh, you know,
right.
that drudge.
Right.
Are you feeling drudge? You look like you're feeling
drudge. I know. We do a prayer call, and every week Stephanie always prays for more opportunities, and I think the rest of us cringe.
Like, no, I think that's true.
But hey, whatever. Oh yeah, we're good with that. Oh my gosh.
But they all seem to work out. I mean, he has been filling our plate. But it's with his stuff, and it's...
They do.
I
just have some things on my plate right now that... Anyway.
Yeah.
That probably should...
Sometimes...
I mean, whatever. It's, you know what?
Right.
Sometimes I just... This is a...
It's
yeah,
a process.
Sometimes I need to stretch myself.
It's a journey.
And say, okay.
That's right. It's a journey. Well, we loved being with you today, and... Yeah, pray about all those things that
yeah.
God would have you do or not do, and allow him to... make your schedule. I think it's so much easier that way.
Uh-huh. Yeah, and I need to go now because I have like a million and one things to do this week. So see ya.
Yeah, I'm really busy too. I have a lot to get done. So yeah, we're going to leave now. And this will allow you to have time to go out and make disciples. See you next time. Hi, this is Stephanie Olson. I just wanted to share a couple of tips that we have learned to help just really increase our quiet time with the Lord and really allow us to spend time with the Lord during the day at all times. I don't know about you, but I have found that Satan, our enemy, loves to distract us when we are having our quiet time. So when you're having your devotions, try and do it without checking the computer or checking Facebook. Or I always have my phone next to me and I will make sure that I only answer calls if it's from the school or a text or something like that, from somebody really important. But try and take away those distractions if you can. And always have a pad and paper next to you. What I find is that thoughts pop into my mind of things that I have to do that day. And it is always great to be able to write that stuff down and set it aside and you can refer back to it later so you don't forget. Try and find a quiet place away from noise, if at all possible, to spend time with the Lord so you can actually hear Him when He speaks to you. And instead of turning on the TV maybe during the day, turn on some worship music and just worship Him during the day. And don't forget to take those moments while you're driving, while you're showering, getting dressed, whatever it might be, and just talk to God. Spend time in prayer. We hope that you have a great time of worship with the Lord on a daily basis and go out and make disciples.